and disease, and most importantly, touch on some of the mechanisms that you can use and some of the protocols that you can use to study epigenetics in the lab. And the idea behind that is that if you ever decided to do a project in the lab that's focusing on epigenetics, it would give you an idea of the type of protocols that you would be using in a way. Okay, so what is epigenetics? Does anyone want to have a go at, like, what do you guys think what epigenetic is? Come on, not that scary. You can either say it right or wrong.
It's like modification of different elements of, like, the chromosome, but not modifying the genetic code. Like, you could be adding a methyl group to a cytosine, or you could be changing the methylation on histones, for example.
Exactly. So the basic thing behind epigenetic is that it can be anything that causes a change without actually causing change in the DNA base. So, for example, it can be, let's say, transcription factors. Some people view transcription factors as epigenetics. Some people disagree with this idea. But obviously, transcription factors can bind to the DNA and can cause a change in the response of your genes without actually causing a change in the DNA sequence. So in a way, that can categorize as an epigenetic mechanism. So the key things in definition of epigenetics is that there are factors that can cause a change in the expression of the genes without changing the DNA sequence. And also, they can be heritable. So they can be passed on from one cell to another cell, but also from one generation to another generation. So as mentioned, there are different types of epigenetic mechanisms. Some of them are listed here. For example, DNA methylation at CpG dinucleotides is one of the most studied epigenetic mechanisms. But then you got things like histone modification and non-coding RNA. Then if you dig deeper into methylation, then you come into concepts such as methylation of adenosines or hydroxymethylation. So there are different types of epigenetic mechanism. There is just not one type. Also, if you have a question, just raise your hand. So I like the lecture to be an interactive lecture. So stop me whenever you have a question. So let's start by introducing the first one, DNA methylation. So basically, DNA methylation is addition of a methyl group to the fifth carbon position of a cytosine base that is next to a guanine base. And this happens via an enzyme known as DNA methyl transferase, or for short, DNMTP. So this particular enzyme would remove a methyl group from a substrate known as SAM for short, or S-adenosine methionine, to the fifth carbon position of a cytosine that's located next to a guanine base, and it creates a methylated cytosine. So this methylated cytosine hasn't actually changed the base. It hasn't caused a mutation. It still is a cytosine at that location. But what it does, it changes the structure of the DNA, and it changes the occupancy. So in a way, it changes the interaction between the DNA and other elements, like transcription factors. By doing that, it can impact expression of the genes. So let's look into this a bit more deeper. So this is the CpG site that we were looking at. And obviously, when you look at a DNA, it's a mirror image. So if you've got a CpG site here, opposite to it, you will have a GC site. So they call them CpG region, because if you look at the DNA structure, you've got your sugar bases here, and then you've got a phosphodiester bond attaching your cytosine and guanine base together. So that's why it's called a CpG. So you're looking at one strand, you're not looking at the opposite strand. So when we say CpG, you're basically referring to C, P, G, these three components. Then if you're thinking about a DNA, because it's a mirror image, so if you're thinking about methylation happening at this cytosine, then opposite to it, you would have a CpG on the other strand. So if there's a methylation happening here, this side would also undergo methylation. So this is what we mean by a mirror image. So if you have a methylation here, opposite to it, you will also have a methylation. So think of it always as a mirror image. So there are different types of methylation events that can happen. Three of the most common ones are listed here. For example, methylation on adenine base, or methylation of cytosine on two locations, for example, N4 and C5. The most common one that is seen in eukaryotes is the C5 methylation. Yeah? Then there are two major classes of DNA methyltransferases. So if you remember, we said methyltransferases are the enzyme that transfer the methyl group from the substrate to the cytosine base. So there are two main categories of them. One of them is known as de novo methyltransferases, and the other one is known as maintenance methyltransferases. So if you think about it, if a DNA is just being synthesized and it doesn't have any methylation pattern or profile, it needs to establish that. So it's a new thing. So that's what is called de novo methyltransferase. So if you have CpG sites opposite to it, the GP site, there are two known DNA methyltransferases, 3A and 3B, that would recognize these sites and will come in and add a methyl group to them. So these are known as de novo, because obviously there wasn't any methylation at this site before. Then there are other ones known as DNA methyltransferase 1, and these work by copying things. So they're known as maintenance methyltransferases. So if you imagine, this is a DNA and it goes under replication. So basically the two strands now become separated, which are now becoming separate. So this is the top strand, this is the bottom strand. A new strand is being synthesized for both of them. So the new strand wouldn't have a methyl group here. What it does is that it uses this one, this specific strand, as a template, and this enzyme, DNA methyltransferase 1, copies exactly what it sees to the bottom strand. That's why it is known as maintenance methyltransferase. So basically, it doesn't set any new methylation patterns, but it just repeats what it sees when DNA is being replicated. So this is the difference between the two DNA methyltransferases. So another component that we touched on was SAM, or S-adenosine methionine. So this is a substrate, it's a metabolite. So where does it come from? The cycle that it generates SAM is known as a one-carbon pathway. It's actually made out of three separate pathways attached to each other. One is known as methionine cycle, which is this big one here. One is known as folate cycle, which is this green one. And the other one is choline pathway, which is this blue one. So we as humans can't synthesize choline and folate. So basically, we get these from our diet. So the source of these are diet. These two are the main methyl donors. So they come in, they go through a cycle, they basically convert homocysteine to methionine, methionine gets converted to SAM, and then SAM acts as a methyl donor for this enzyme DNA methyltransferases, and itself gets converted to something known as SAH. And then the cycle carries on. So there's a lot of details on this slide. I don't expect you all to know all the cycle by detail. Just the key component of it is sufficient. And the main thing to remember is that when that SAM gets converted to SAH, usually the substrate has a high binding affinity to DNA methyltransferases to their enzyme. But in this case, this enzyme is a bit unusual. SAH has a higher affinity to DNA methyltransferase. So the key thing here is that SAH has to be removed from the site of production quite fast. Because if it doesn't get removed, it stays bound to the enzyme, the DNA methyltransferase, and inhibits DNA methylation. So it's quite key for SAH, S-adenosine homocysteine, to get converted to homocysteine and gets removed from site of production. So the cycle carries on going. So you can easily imagine a condition when the folate and choline are low in the diet. So what would happen in that case? Any guesses? So if, for example, these two are low in the diet, methionine would be low. So what would happen? Exactly. So this is the key thing. So these can be controlled through diet. So these are key components. So there need to be sufficient amount in the diet, because if they're not there sufficiently, it means that your main Nephi donor, Sam, wouldn't be sufficiently present, and therefore there isn't enough Nephi group present to actually drive the DNA methylation forward. So this is another component of DNA methylation. This would lead us to another component in DNA methylation, and that's the idea of CpG islands. So if you think about it, there are 16 different dinucleotide mixtures. So if there are 16 possible dinucleotides, what would you expect by chance a CpG to occur? So there's 16 different combinations. So what would be by chance the ratio of the CpG to occur?
It's not 16.
Brilliant. So by chance you would expect each of these to occur 1 in 16. Imagine this to be a DNA strand, this blue one. So by chance, as you're going through a DNA strand, you should see each of these by chance 1 in 16. But there are certain regions of DNA that this particular CpG dinucleotide gets repeated one after another. These are known as CpG islands. That's why they call them islands, because they're much more frequent than the usual. So in a way, instead of having CpG, GA, GT, you get regions of CG, 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 CG repeating. These are known as CpG islands. And one thing about CpG islands is that they're seen quite a lot at the promoter regions. Bear that in mind, because we've got to come back to it. So we're trying to build the different components, then we want to put them together. The other thing to remember is that there are two different methylation profiles in animals seen. Plants are completely different. So let's ignore plants for now. But in animals, usually there are two different methylation patterns seen. One is known as global methylation pattern, and the other one is known as sporadic methylation pattern. And usually the division is between vertebrates and invertebrates. It's not always the case, but most of the cases, that's where the division falls. So the ones that are vertebrates have the global methylation pattern, and the ones that are invertebrates have the sporadic methylation pattern. So this can look a bit challenging, but just completely ignore this bar chart. The part that I want you to look at is the dots. So if you read the bottom bit here, you see that this is the 1 kb upstream. Then you've got exon 1, intron 1, exon 2, intron 2, and it carries on going. Yeah? So this is representing a section of a genome. So the 1 kb upstream would have the promoter region, yeah, transcription start site. What happens is that in vertebrate, mouse and humans for example, the level of methylation is very, very high starting from mid-exon 1, and it remains high. So most of the time, if you look at the genome of a human or a mouse, you find them severely methylated. So the level of methylation is quite high. The region that's low is just exon 1 and the 1 kb upstream. So that's why it's known as global methylation, because the majority of the sites is heavily methylated. There are some just regions that are not methylated. But now if we look at an invertebrate, in this case a crustacean called Daphnia, the methylation pattern is completely different. What you would see is that the methylation level, these dots, peaks in exon 2, exon 3, and exon 4, and then it drops down. And it's also still low for exon 1 and 1 kb. So in a way, it's the opposite picture. Majority of the places are unmethylated. Certain regions are methylated. So that's why it's known as sporadic methylation, because obviously they're a bit more rare. It's like a desert. You just have to find the methylation in a way. So these are the two common methylation patterns. So now, what we're going to do is to put that information all together. So you learn about DNA methyl transferases, about CpG islands, and the two different methylation profiles. Now, imagine a gene, and this is a promoter region. Yeah? We're looking at a vertebrate. The promoter region has CpG islands usually. And CpG islands usually are free of methylation. Yeah, that's the most common pattern. CpG islands are free of methylation, and this is the promoter region. If it's free of methylation, therefore it allows binding to transcription factors to that site. Therefore, the transcription factor can easily access the promoter, and it starts transcription. But imagine the opposite. That CpG island that usually is free of methylation becomes methylated. Now it's occupying and changing the shape of that DNA. Therefore, the transcription factor can't bind to that promoter region, and therefore that gene is no longer expressed. So can you see how by changing methylation, you can actually change the consequence? Yeah? So, now, remember what we said about the global and sporadic methylation. The difference is there are two different views of looking at it. You got methylation at gene bodies, and you got methylation at the promoter or the 1 kb upstream and exons. So if I say methylation, what would be the first thing that would come into your mind in terms of expression? What does it do to expression?
Turns it off.
Exactly. So that's the most common response, that methylation turns off gene expression. Yeah? And for many, many years before that, methylation turns off expression. You see methylation, genes no longer express. But it's really location dependent. If methylation happens in exon 2 onwards, it usually actually turns on expression. So gene body methylation has a positive correlation with expression. If it happens at exon 1 and 1 kb, it does exactly what you just mentioned. It suppresses expression. So in a way, that methylation is location dependent in terms of what it does to transcription. And this is why these two patterns of methylation are important. Because usually, with vertebrates, their genome is much more complicated. They have much more massive introns. So introns in vertebrates are very, very small. So this needs a bit of background, but anyway. So introns and exons, exons are usually roughly the same, but the intron sizes differ between vertebrates and invertebrates. Invertebrates' introns are usually smaller, usually, there's exceptions. But in humans and mammals, we have massive, massive introns. And usually in these introns, we usually have quite a lot of transposable elements. Transposable elements, you don't want them to be expressed. So that's why a human or a mammal genome, the pattern of methylation is very, very different. You have high levels of methylation carrying on. Main reason is because of regulation of exon-intron boundaries, splicing, and also transposable element suppression. Yeah? But vertebrates don't have that issue as such. Therefore, their body is low. And what it also shows, if you think about it, if you think of the evolutionary side of it, if we're starting from invertebrate, DNA methylation's role here has always been positive. Because if you see any methylation here, it would positively correlate with expression. It didn't need it to suppress expression of the genes as much. But in vertebrates, where the gene body methylation has gone so much high, then in that case, all of those genes would be expressed. So it needed a secondary mechanism. And that's where the promoter methylation comes in. So in a way, the negative correlation between gene expression and methylation in vertebrates is a secondary mechanism that's been evolved that is not necessarily present in invertebrates. Does that make sense? Okay. So, in a way, if you look at here, then this summarizes everything. If you have transcription start site and the beginning of it being methylated, it does exactly what we described. It inhibits binding of the transcription factors and it inhibits gene expression. If you have it at the transposable sites, so in the introns, it suppresses the expression of the transposable elements, but the gene is still expressed. It doesn't affect the expression of that gene. If it happens in the boundaries, so in a way in the introns and exons boundaries, it still has a positive correlation with the expression of that gene. So this is why it shows the location of methylation is important. So in a way, the always you want to ask, so where are you looking at when you're thinking about methylation? Are you looking at transcription start sites, or are you looking at transposable elements, or are you looking at gene body? Then you can start to interpret how it actually interacts with gene expression. So was that part clear? Any questions before we actually progress to the next stage? Okay, I'm going to take the silence as everyone's following and everything's clear. So far, methylation has been seen as a stable epigenetic change, that once it happens, it actually stays. It can't be removed. But now we know that's actually incorrect. Methylation can be removed. And the reason they thought that it can't be removed, because for a methylation reaction to occur, the cell uses quite a lot of energy. So it seemed quite a lot of contradictory act to methylate something and remove the methyl group later on to express it. So that's why they assume that methylation can't be removed. And also they hadn't figured out what enzyme is responsible for it. And now we know that there are actually, so this is quite important, so there are actually two ways of removing DNA methylation. Yeah? One is known as passive replication coupled DNA demethylation, which is shown here. So this is TET independent. What I mean by that is that basically if you have a methylated CpG site, it has to always be maintained. So do you remember the maintenance enzyme? So it has to, when it's replicating, it always has to be maintained. So DNA methyltransferase 1 has to constantly maintain that methylation. If something goes wrong in that maintenance, you lose methylation pattern. So that's one way that gets removed. So in a way, if there is something wrong with it, with this process of maintenance, a mistake is made, your methylation pattern gets removed. So this is passive, it's replication dependent. But there are also enzymes that are responsible for removing it. And these are known as TET enzymes. TET stands for 10-11 translocation enzymes. What they do is that they recognize a 5-methyl cytosine and they convert it by oxidation to 5-hydroxymethyl cytosine. So can you see here? So this is your CH group, so this is the methyl group that was added. One of the H's is converted to a hydroxyl group. So now you actually have a modification called 5-hydroxymethyl cytosine. Then what TET enzymes do is that they can convert this 5-hydroxymethyl cytosine to 5-formyl cytosine. And then what they can also do is to convert this to 5-carboxycytosine. And then that 5-carboxycytosine can get converted to a cytosine. And the way that this gets converted is that there are two other enzymes known as TDG and base excision repairs that would recognize these 5-formyl cytosine and 5-carboxycytosine as mistakes. They think they're mutations. So they basically remove that site, remove that base, and they create an A-basic site. And then what happens is when you've got a base removal, base excision repair pathways come into action, and they use the mirror strand, and they see, okay, there was a G there, so they put a C. But obviously they won't put a methylated cytosine because they just look at, oh, okay, there was a G, so I'll just put a C. So you end up losing your methylation via these enzymes known as TET enzymes. So you've got two pathways of removal of methylation, one that was replication dependent, and one is that is replication dependent. So this was a brief introduction to DNA methylation. So hopefully with that you have a good idea of what DNA methylation is, what are the components in DNA methylation. So another one that we want to actually touch on is histone modification. But before we actually start it, is there any question that anyone wants to ask? How does the de novo work?
How the enzyme knows where to add the methylation?
That's a very good question, and we still don't know. So they think that it's guided by proteins that bind. Some people think that there are certain proteins that bind and guide where the enzyme has to methylate. And some people think it's based on lack of protection. Basically, anywhere that in DNA is not protected from the action of DNA methyltransferases gets methylated. So there's two views, and no one still knows exactly which one's the correct one.
Does TET remove both sides of methylation?
It can remove both, and it can remove just one of them.
Okay, if it removes one, what stops the maintenance one, just adding it back in?
It can remove it, but sometimes they make mistakes and they don't end up removing it. But most of the time, TET works as removing both of them.
Okay.
But sometimes it does happen that it only removes one.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay. So another component that we're going to touch on is histone modifications. And the reason for that is that we're going to reach to this stage. So basically, we're going to be able to look at this slide, and you're all going to interpret what's happening here. So that's our aim. So hopefully, by the end of the next half an hour, you all can look at this image and easily follow it and see what's happening. That's our aim, yeah? So when you think about histone modifications, there are multiple different... I'm kind of jumping between slides, so... I'm slightly moving between the slides that you have. It might not come in the same order. So there are two different levels. One, you have the actual core histone, which is here. And the other bit is the histone tail, which is hanging out. Yeah? So if I say histone, what's the major role of histone that everyone learns in high school? What does it do?
Stabilizes the DNA, the chromatin.
Exactly. So one of the major roles of histone is that it compacts your DNA. Yeah? 2 meters of DNA has to be in, I think it's 0.6 micrometer, something like that, space, something like that, I can't exactly remember. But basically, it compacts the DNA by wrapping the DNA very tightly around it. Does anyone know how it does that? Why does DNA bind around histone quite tightly? What's the charge of DNA? What's the charge of histone? Exactly. So you've got positive and negative. Therefore, they're going to attach quite tightly around each other. So that's first rule of histone. It has a structural role. It organizes the DNA. But you also have another role, which comes down to these tails that are hanging out. These are amino acids. These amino acids can be modified with different enzymes. They can be methylated, ubiquinated, or they can become acetylated. Each of those will change the interaction of the histone with the DNA. But also, it's much more complicated than actually looking at DNA methylation, because it's actually sensitive. This is why they call them histone codes. They're actually like a code. Because if you, let's imagine, if you have acetylation on histone H2, the tail of histone H2, and then you have acetylation on H4 on amino acid 8, it can have a different consequence to if you just had acetylation here. So it's not as simple as if you just see this, it means this. It depends on the combination of different modifications that's attached to the histone tail. Also, to read this histone tail is quite easy. So if it's histone H2, then you started with H2. If it's acetylation, it will follow with acetylation. then if it's then you would bring the name of the amino acid that's attached. So for example, if you see lysine, then you say lysine location 4. So these numbers refer to the location of the amino acid on the tail of the histone, but that makes sense in a minute. So bear that in mind, that you basically realize that histones are positively charged, and DNA is negatively charged, it structures the DNA in a way. Now we're going to try to figure out how do we change the tails of the histone to cause a change in the expression of the gene. To understand that, we need to break this image into smaller sections. To do that, I want to introduce you to several key components. One is known as polycomb repressive complexes. So polycomb proteins are usually involved in structuring the chromatin to a repressive status. So there are two different polycomb repressive complexes. One referred as polycomb repressive complex 1, and the other one is referred as 2. So I don't expect you to know all the subunits of these two complexes. The only key thing that I want you to remember is that polycomb proteins are involved in repression of expression. Yeah? So if you see them and if they come along, their role is to repress chromatin to inhibit expression. And what I want you to remember is that polycomb repressive complex 2, what it does, it recognizes a modification called as H3K27. So does anyone want to read that code for me? What does H3K27 mean?
Histone 3 lysine 27.
Brilliant. So that's how you end up reading it. So I'm looking at histone 3 and I'm looking at the tail of the histone. K stands for lysine and lysine number 27 on the tail of the histone H3. So polycomb repressive complex 2 recognizes this specific lysine, and what it does, it basically methylates it. It adds 3 methyl groups to it, and when it does that, it suppresses expression. Now, polycomb repressive complex 1 recognizes H2AK119. So what that means is that it recognizes location 119 and it ubiquinates this. So this also is associated with transcriptional suppression. So far, you learned that polycomb repressive complexes are involved in transcriptional suppression by causing these two modifications on the tail of the histones. Another component to remember is TRXG proteins. If you see TRXG proteins coming along, they're associated with expression. They modify the structure of the chromatin to induce expression. And the way that they do it is that they recognize H3K4. So H3K4, what does it stand for?
Histone 3 lysine.
Exactly. So it recognizes the tail of the histone H3, lysine 4 on the tail, and it adds a methyl group to it. So by doing that, it actually induces expression. Another component, the last component that we want to know about, is deacetylases, known as SYN3 and NORD. So if you see these two coming along, there are two key components in the structure of these two. One is known as methyl binding domain, which actually recognizes methylated region, and the other key component that they have is these, HTAC. So histone deacetylases, so their role is to remove acetyl groups. Now we're going to go back to this and try to read this basic code. Yeah? So, before we start, what does acetylation do? What's the what would it do to a charge? Imagine you got a DNA that's wrapped around histones. So you've got a positive and a negative, and you start adding acetyl group to the tail of the histone. What would be the consequence of that?
Does it neutralize the charge?
Exactly. So if you start adding acetyl group to the tail of the histone and it's neutralizing, what would be the consequence?
Reduce the interaction between the DNA and the histone.
And what would it lead to? Gene expression.
Yeah.
So in a way, you can see how these modifications can play around with also the charges and can loosen up the histones, the core histone from the DNA, and lead to a response in a way. Okay, so let's try to read this code. So we're going to start with very top. So I don't have actually a laser pointer, so I'm actually going to use this mouse. Try to follow this mouse. So this is a strand of DNA that we're focusing on. It has methyl groups attached to it first, yeah? And it has acetyl groups here. So we want to change it from a highly condensed closed chromatin structure to a transcribed region. So what changes do we need to do? So one thing that we need to do to actually suppress the expression of this and switch it from an expressed to a non-expressed region is to change acetylation and methylation. So if we said that acetylation actually loosens it and it causes expression, so we need to remove these acetyl groups from the H3K27 region. So do you see that marker above, H3K27, shown with acetylation? So basically, this is this marker. The first step that we need to do is to remove the acetylation from H3K27. So acetylation was associated with expression. The first step that we did, we brought in an enzyme. The print here is small, so actually have a look at your handouts. That's a hashtag. So hashtags will end up removing the acetyl group from H3K27. Yeah? So the acetyl group is now removed. Then what happens is that the polycomb repressive complex 2 comes in. What did polycomb repressive complex 2 do? Exactly. So now that acetylation is removed from H3K27 and is free. Polycomb repressive complex 2 comes along and it terimethylates it. Terimethylated lysine 27, what was it associated with? Exactly. So now you have H3K27 that's terimethylated. So that modification acts as an anchoring site and a recognition for polycomb repressive complex 1. Now, when polycomb repressive complex 1 comes in, what does it do? It ubiquinates lysine 119. So when it causes that change, these two are associated with transcriptional suppression. And also what it does is these changes will bring in the two complexes that we just talked about, Nordansyn-3A. Nordansyn-3A are also deacetylases and also induce methylation. The reason they do that is that these sites, these two modifications, H3K27, and the 119 ubiquination, these two are recognized by DNA methyl transferases. They'll come in and they start methylating CpG sites. Yeah? And because they're methylated, these two, the SYN3A and the NORD, have methyl binding sites. They can now bind to the methylated CpG sites and continue to deacetylate. So that also causes compaction of the chromatin structure. Yeah? And therefore, you move from an express to a suppressive state. Yeah? Opposite to this, you just move backwards. And then you know the TRXG can actually come in and actually cause an opposite effect. So hopefully, by actually looking at the different components, now you can start slightly looking at literature and reading into the codes and figuring out, okay, how does this link with each other? Does this figure now make sense? Can you follow it? Okay, good. If you don't, this is the time to actually say something because we actually have a 2-hour slot, so we can move quite slow. So in a way, what I also want to emphasize is that it's a teamwork. You don't just look at methylation on its own. There's methylation working in combination with histone modification to cause an effect. So obviously CpG sites are your DNA, so it's the methylation. Then you also got the histone pairs, which are the histone tails. These combination of the changes can change a structure from a relaxed chromatin to more of a compact and vice versa. So this is how gene expression can easily change. So now imagine your cells in your body is going through cell cycle, yeah? Or your cells, as we sit in here, they're differentiating. So certain genes need to be expressed in heart, certain genes need to be suppressed in heart. This is one of the ways that they're constantly activating and inactivating. Imagine the complexity that's happening in each different types of cells at the same time. So the third one that we're going to touch on, to just give you a bit of a background, is non-coding RNA. So why are they called non-coding? Exactly, they don't produce protein. So they're referred to as non-coding because they don't relate to specific protein products. So the way that they work is that you've got a double-stranded RNA. That double-stranded RNA, there's an enzyme known as dicer. It comes along, and if this is a bigger fragment, it starts chopping out to smaller pieces. Then it becomes single-stranded. Then it binds to another protein, forms a complex known as RISC, or RNA-induced suppressive complex, or silencing complex. And what it does is now, because it's single-stranded, it can recognize complementary regions of DNA, of RNA, bind to it, and inhibit either transcription or translation. So that's how they end up working. So this slide is quite important because it shows you overview of the different things that non-coding RNA can actually achieve. So I recommend that you look at this review if you have time, and have a look at the different functions of them. For example, this orange section that's been highlighted, it relates to highlighting a promoter region of a non-coding protein, yeah? And this blue section is another gene. One thing that they can do is that the non-coding RNA can inhibit transcription of another gene, so number one, transcriptional interference. Or they can actually promote chromatin remodeling, so they can induce, histone codes to be changed, methylation changes, and cause chromatin remodeling, and actually activate it, so they can induce that chromatin changes. Another thing that they can do is that this non-coding RNA can be an anti-strand. So that one is your strand, and that's your anti-strand. So therefore, this is a transcript. So what happens is that it finds this complementary region and binds to it because it's single-stranded and it's now found this match. Now it can have several consequences. If you see, this is a bigger region. These are exons highlighted. These are introns. But it also is covering a bit of the intron. So what it does is that it interferes with the intron-exon boundary and it starts affecting splicing. So therefore, it can modulate alternative splicing. It can lead to skipping of an exon or inducing a alternative splicing event. It also can act as a cleavage, so it can actually basically induce breakage of this transcript in a way, which is the first one that we saw in the previous rule. What it can also do, these non-coding RNA can bind to proteins. So this gray section here is supposed to be a protein. It can bind to proteins and bulk themselves up and modulate the activity of that protein by binding to that protein. Or it can cause a structural or organizational change in the protein, or it can cause the location of the protein to change. For example, a protein needs to be, let's say, in the nucleus, by binding on this, it ends up in the cytoplasm. So it can actually change the location of that protein. Or it can actually just break down into small RNA precursors, so it just breaks down into smaller and smaller chunks in a way. So these are just some of the roles of non-coding RNAs. So I like to highlight this quite a lot, because when you look at research, what you see is a research paper that's just focusing on DNA methylation, or a research paper that's just focusing on histone modification, unless you look at review papers. The reason for that is that each of these components are so complex that one lab might end up spending 30 years just working on one single histone modification. So it's impossible for the lab to actually focus on all the epigenetic modification. But it's quite important to remember that there's always an interaction between them. It doesn't happen individually. So usually, if you have a DNA methylation change, you have a chromatin modification as well. You also have non-coding RNAs also appearing as well. So in a way, it's a crosstalk between them. So this last slide on epigenetic mechanisms, it's also here to show you, this is a good paper if you have time, have a look through it. It's also to show you that the three that we just touched on barely touch the surface of what epigenetic factors there exist. There are so many different epigenetic factors. For example, imagine a nucleus and your DNA is inside it. So if a DNA in this nucleus is in the center, versus a DNA section that's out on the outer center, can you imagine that the effect of expression on these would be different? And how would it be different? Can you think of a way? Section of the DNA in the middle versus on the outside. What would be so different between these two locations? Accessibility. So imagine a DNA that's been compacted in, and the center of that DNA in the middle is less accessible to the outside. So what this is highlighting is also the position of your DNA strand in the nucleus is also important in terms of how expressed that gene is. Usually the genes that are highly more expressed are on the outer section than in the middle. So that also shows that the structure and the way that they've been compacted in, it also affects expression, and that's an epigenetic mechanism. Or another way to think of it is actually these regions that are labeled as TAD, or topologically associated domain. What that means is that don't think of a DNA as a 2D dimension. Think of it as a 3D, yeah? Imagine, I should bring a piece of string that will actually make it a bit more easier. But imagine a piece of string, that's your DNA, yeah? Now, take that piece of string and create a flower shape, yeah? Then once you've created this flower shape, take the rest of the string that's left over, create another flower shape next to it, and create another flower shape, and carry on going, yeah? Each of these flower shapes are known as TAD size. What means is that this flower is created in a 3D image. So because what it does, when it's actually creating that flower and that loops, it's bringing certain location in your DNA, in your chromosome, closer to another region. So if there's an enhancer here, and now there's a loop here, it's now closer to another gene, that otherwise if it was quite straight, it would have been several thousands of base pair away from it. So in a way, this 3D structure, this looping, also creates interactions. It creates interaction between enhancers and suppressors. It creates different distances between regions. And what it also means that if a region is in one TAD site, these are going to interact much more closer together versus the TAD site next to them. And this region is going to interact closer, these two, to each other than the third one. So in a way, you start thinking about 3D dimensions and also positioning and structuring. And that's also something quite important. Okay, so what we're gonna now do is to slightly move away from the mechanisms of epigenetic and start thinking about examples of epigenetics, yeah? So one of the things that they're important in is differentiation. So I briefly mentioned that if you think about it, all your different types of cells, all your different types of tissues are generated from a single cell, yeah? And that single cell has the same DNA material that it is in all your other cells in your body. But phenotypically, how different is your heart from your lung? Very different, isn't it? Their functions are very different. They have the same identical genetic material. And part of it, I'm not saying 100%, that would be my bias, we are working on epigenetics, but part of it is linked to epigenetic factors, because obviously they say, okay, during differentiation, this is going to be developed to, let's say, a lung tissue, this is going to be developed into heart, therefore these are the core genes that need to be expressed in this one, whereas it needs to be suppressed in this one. So by changing the epigenetic marks, we can actually change which genes need to be expressed. So this is quite important. One of the main roles of epigenetics is in tissue differentiation. It's one of the biggest areas of research. And this shows it quite nicely. It's now a dated paper, but everyone uses it because it was one of the first that actually showed it really nicely. Have you come across heat maps? If you have, just raise your hand so I know if I have to explain you or not. Okay, not that many. Okay, so this, what you're looking at, is a heat map, and at the top is a clustering. So the way that it works is that you can have it different ways, but in this case, each of the columns is a tissue, different type of sample, and each row is a CpG site. Yeah? And what they have done for these types of tissues, which are each of the columns, they measured the methylation of these CpG sites. And if they're very methylated, they showed it with blue. If they're unmethylated, they showed it with yellow. And then what they do is they do clustering, so based on how similar these are. So what you can see here is blocks of color at the top, yeah? So that means that you basically can separate your different types of tissue based on their methylation pattern. So by looking at, for example, here, which is blood, compared to, blood, red, compared to here, which is orange, infant versus adult, even infant versus adult, you can separate it. You can actually separate it based on methylation profile. So in a way, that shows the involvement of DNA methylation in tissue differentiation. So for example, let's say, if you gave me a sample of a tissue, tell me what sample, obviously it would be unfair if you just gave me any sample, but said, okay, this is a human sample, tell me what type of tissue it is. I can look at this paper and say, well, if I look at the methylation of this many number of CpG sites, I can tell you if it is one of these tissues. So there are quite a lot of databases nowadays available. For example, there's something called Human Atlas Project that basically they generated methylation profile for mice and human, different types of tissue, and now they're moving to single cells. And we can look at the methylation profiles and determine what type of tissue they are. So this is one of the main roles of methylation. So how do they actually achieve that? So we learn about two markers. One is H3K27 terimethylation, and one is H3K4 terimethylation. So, can anyone remind me, what does each of these markers stand for? H3K4 terimethylation, what did it do? Is this like? What did it do?
Activated.
Exactly. So H3K4 terimethylation activates. What does H3K27 terimethylation does? So we got this information. Now we're looking at this. We have a region. It has a bivalent. It's a bivalent region. So it has both of the codes. It's got H3K27 terimethylation. What was it a marker of?
Repression.
And a marker of?
Activation.
So what would it do to that region? Imagine a region that has both a marker of activation and suppression. What would happen to that gene?
It depends on the protein
that you want. Yeah. Imagine something that's ready to go, yeah? It can go either way. It's kind of poised, yeah? Instead of like, imagine a movie, you pause there, yeah? So you can either press the stop button or you can press the play button.
This is exactly what's happening to this gene. It's got both markers. It can either be stopped and not expressed, or it can be expressed. So in a way, it's been poised. So if it decides that, you know what, this gene needs to be suppressed, therefore it leaves this marker on and inhibits RNA polymerases and inhibits gene expression. But if it decides that, you know what, this needs to be removed, it ends up removing this, therefore this marker inhibits DNA methyl transferases from coming along and methylating this region, and that gene becomes expressed. So these are genes that are poised. They're quite important during development. Because if you think about it, in your stem cells, you've got quite a lot of genes that are in that situation. They need to decide if they're going to be expressed or not. And that's basically on the decision of if they are needed or not. For example, if they are going to maintain a stem cell status or if they're going to become a committed cell. So in this case, let's have a look. So we got H3K27 terry methylation. Ignore that one. H3K4 terry methylation. So both markers are here. And it's gone under differentiation. We got two different scenarios. So this one ends up with a red. H3K27 terry methylation. What would you tell you in terms of the role of that gene for a committed cell? Is it needed or not? Exactly. What would it tell you about this one? We ended up with the H3K4 terry methylation. So that's how it decides that if a cell undergoes, like, committed to one or another. So these are known as bivalent domains. So these are basically have these two modifications on them. They're known as poised regions. So they can undergo each way. So they can either stay as they are, this section, or they can actually form each of the two different paths. So that creates an immediate response to a change in a way. So that's quite important for development. So bear that in mind. Now, let's look at development in a bit more detail. To understand methylation changes that happen during development, we need to understand one more concept, and that's imprinting. So how many people know about imprinting and methylation? What is imprinting? If you're clever, you just read the slide and tell me. Committed cell. Is it needed or not? Exactly. What would it tell you about this one? We ended up with the H3K4 terry methylation. So that's how it decides that if a cell undergoes, like, committed to one or another. So these are known as bivalent domains. So these are basically have these two modifications on them. They're known as poised regions. So they can undergo each way. So they can either stay as they are, this section, or they can actually form each of the two different paths. So that creates an immediate response to a change in a way. So that's quite important for development. So bear that in mind. Now, let's look at development in a bit more detail. To understand methylation changes that happen during development, we need to understand one more concept, and that's imprinting. So, how many people know about imprinting and methylation? What is imprinting? If you're clever, you just read the slide and tell me. Go for it. What is imprinting? What's the worst that can happen? You have a guess and it's wrong. Okay, so basically imprinting means that the gene is either expressed in a maternal or paternal allele. So obviously for all our genes we've got two alleles, yeah? And the common thing is that the both of them are expressed. So, but there are certain genes that are known as imprinting gene and only one is expressed. And the decision in terms of which one is expressed depends on if they're coming from the paternal or maternal side, yeah? These are known as imprinting. And there are different theories in terms of why imprinting exists. And one of the theories that you will end up reading quite a lot about is called the parent conflict hypothesis. And the simplest way to explain it is that it basically means that the criteria of the mother and the father are not the same. So let's imagine there's a gene, yeah? And that gene would cause the growth of an embryo to the cost of the mother, yeah? So if it comes from the paternal side, obviously the paternal has the drive for the growth of the embryo, so you want it to be expressed. But obviously it becomes quite dangerous for the mother to if it takes over, because obviously it needs to survive itself as well. So that's why it causes conflict, because obviously the interest of the paternal and the maternal in terms of the level of expression of that gene is different. So that's one of the hypotheses in terms of why imprinting genes been generated. And this has been shown here in terms of imprinting genes. So this is a gene, the two alleles. You can see that the promoter region of this gene is one is expressed, one is methylated. And you can always tell which one it comes from, because we already have characterized imprinting gene in humans and mice. We know every possible imprinting gene, most of them. So this strand is coming from, let's say, mother, and it's methylated and unexpressed. This strand comes from the father, it's unmethylated and expressed. So if you look at the two alleles in the embryo, you find different methylation pattern at the promoter region for these two, alleles. And that's these are called imprinting genes. Is that clear, the concept of imprinting? Okay. So the reason we needed to understand about imprinting is to be able to interpret this diagram. So this diagram summarizes everything. You know, we had a very interesting question about how do you decide de novo methylation and that sort of thing. So this brings everything together. So this is reprogramming events. Imagine, let's say, your body. So I just mentioned that if it's going through development, each different type of tissue would have a specific methylation pattern, yeah? Now, imagine sperm and sperm and egg oocyte, yeah? They all would also, they're different types of tissues, aren't they? They're different types of cells. So they would have their own unique methylation. Now, we have the egg. Now, what it needs to differentiate and form the different types of tissues. So it needs to lose this methylation, past methylation pattern, and re-establish it. So there needs to be stages that methylation has to be flexible and removed. These are known as reprogramming events. And this is shown here in this diagram. There are two different reprogrammings happening in humans, and this is shown here. The easiest way to look at this is to start with the second half of it. And once you actually understood this bit, then we go to this section. Yeah? So imagine that we got the oocyte and the sperm. Each of them have a unique methylation pattern, yeah? And now they're combined and we have the zygote. The zygote also needs to now remove that methylation pattern and establish it in a tissue-specific manner as the embryo is developing. So this drop in the line shows that the methylation pattern from the alleles from the mother and the father are getting removed and gets reset as the embryo is developing. And the lowest stage is during blastocyst, and therefore all methylation pattern is removed and reset. So if you think about it, that's quite a sensitive stage. So I don't think I actually have put the slide in, but have you heard about folate supplement during pregnancy? Yeah. What did we say about folate? What was it? Exactly. And what does it provide for the methylation? Exactly. And why is it needed?
To make the methylation.
For reprogramming. Imagine if there isn't sufficient amount of nephile donor and there's a massive reprogramming happening here during embryogenesis, you can mess up the methylation pattern of the embryo. This is why they always recommend taking folate supplement during pregnancies. One of the reasons. So now you have an embryo. Each tissue in that embryo has its own specific methylation pattern that's happened during embryogenesis. But we heard about imprinting genes, and we said that imprinting gene, their methylation comes from paternal or maternal allele. So basically, their methylation is independent of the embryo. It comes from the previous generation. So their A1. This embryo is already forming the oocytes and the sperms in a way. Yeah? So you got the next generation forming. So we go here. So these are the stem cells that form the sperm and the oocyte. Yeah? So what happens is that depending on if they want to become and form the sperm or the oocyte, their methylation has to be removed and reset in that specific pattern. Because we said that there are certain genes that can be either methylated or unmethylated based on which parent they come from. Yeah? So therefore, the methylation pattern of a sperm and oocyte is different. So that's the second methylation reprogramming that happens. In a way, the methylation of the sperm, the stem cells that form the sperm and egg gets removed and reset based on the fact that they're going to form a sperm or oocyte. And that then drives forward the embryo in a way. So now you can follow the cycle, the two stages of reprogramming that happens. And bear in mind that we said these imprinting genes that are formed here don't get removed. So basically, there are so many number of hundreds of genes or so that are known as imprinting genes that their methylation pattern got set during that stage. And during the second reprogramming event, their methylation doesn't get removed and reset, similar to everything else. Their methylation is stable. Whatever happens, their methylation doesn't change. So if you think about it, that's quite an interesting concept, because imagine something goes wrong at this stage, yeah? And there's a mistake in the imprinting genes, yeah? And they are forming the next generation, and their methylation is not getting reset. So that's how you actually can pass on epigenetic changes from one generation to another generation, and that's your imprinting genes, because their methylation doesn't get reset during embryogenesis. So when you come across epigenetic inheritance, that's the stage that they're referring to. Basically, genes that are imprinted and their methylation doesn't get reset. So this is shown and summarized in this figure, in a way. So, in a way, this is showing you the imprinting genes, that their methylation pattern never gets reset and it gets passed on. So if you have a mistake here, basically it can be passed on to multiple generations. And this is a good example of imprinting genes. So do you remember the conflict theory? So this is one of the good examples, and this is one of the reasons that they came up with that hypothesis in a way. So we have a gene called insulin growth factor 2. This particular gene enhances growth, yeah? So it drives growth forward. This is a paternal strand, this is a maternal strand, yeah? And this is the insulin growth factor. This is the gene body, this is supposed to be the promoter region just behind it. Then we have a non-coding element here, which is known as H19. H19 suppresses the expression of insulin growth factor, so it has a negative effect on the expression of that. Then for this to have an effect, it needs to recognize a receptor, known as insulin growth factor 2 receptor. So you've got three elements. You have a gene that promotes growth, but for it to have an action, it needs to bind to a receptor, and also there's a regulator known as H19, which is an encoding RNA that suppresses the expression of that gene. So you have three components. This is an imprinting gene, these three. What happens is in the paternal allele, we said that what they want to do is to promote growth of the embryo at the cost of the mother. So their interest is that this particular gene is active. Therefore, the promoter region is unmethylated, the gene body is methylated, it drives expression forward. And this, which inhibits the expression of this gene, becomes methylated at the promoter region and the gene body is unmethylated. So basically, it's suppressing the element that controls the expression and suppresses the expression of this. But to be not completely unfair, what also happens is that the receptor for this element becomes methylated at the promoter region. So basically, the paternal allele doesn't have the receptor for this gene. Yeah? Now, if you look at the maternal strand, the opposite thing is happening. To balance out the expression of this, it methylates it and it suppresses this. And what it does, it also activates this gene to suppress the expression of that. But what it does, for this to have some effect, it actually activates the gene that expresses the receptor for that gene. So it kind of is fine-tuning everything. So it kind of says, we need a bit of expression, but don't go mad with it. So therefore, I'm going to control the other ones. And that's why it's called imprinting, because there's different methylation happening, and also there's different levels of consequence and cost to the embryo in terms of how expressed they are. So does that make sense, and is it quite clear now? Okay, good. So with that, hopefully what you now have is a good idea of epigenetic mechanisms, how they regulate gene expression, and also, most importantly for me, is to take away the idea of reprogramming and the sensitive stages in methylation. Because what that would show you is this figure. So it basically shows that we are quite susceptible to our environment. So have you ever come across the idea of, let me see if I actually have put it in. Yeah, I have. So have you come across the idea of that what you eat is what you eat, basically, and it makes you and determines you? Part of that is epigenetic, because they always say that epigenetic acts as an interface between the genetic material and environment. What it does is senses the environment and it fine-tunes the expression of the genes based on the signals that it's receiving from the environment. For example, let's say you have a diet that drives methylation forward at certain genes that are needed, or unmethylates genes that are need to be suppressed. So in a way, it changes the way that the genes are behaving. So this is where the idea of the interaction between environment and the genome comes in. And this is why they say, basically, to a certain extent, it's not all about your genetic material. You can obviously there are mutations. There are certain things that is in your genetic code and you can't change it. But there are certain things that are in your own hand and you can change it by changing your environment and your surroundings. Because if you change your environment, your surrounding and your behavior, it actually changes your epigenetic material. And by changing your epigenetic material, you can also change your disease risk factors as well. This is shown in twins. Twins are ideal models for epigenetic studies. And the reason for that is that twins have the same genetic material. Is there a question? Okay. So twins start with the same genetic material, but they also start with the same epigenetic material as well. And this is shown with this paper. There's quite a lot of twin studies after this research, but this is the kind of the landmark of epigenetics and twin studies in a way. What this is showing is that they basically, what they've done is they put chromosomes, I think it's chromosome number 5, I don't know exactly, but chromosomes number 5, let's say, from twins on top of each other at age 3. Yeah? And if their epigenetic material is the same, they become yellow. If the epigenetic material for those regions are not the same, they become green or red based on if it's hyper or hypomethylated. Yeah? And what they did is that they followed up these twins until age 50 and they re-looked at their epigenetic profile. And what you can see is that although they've got the same genetic material, now their epigenetic profile is less matching. You got much more green and reds coming, so basically their methylation levels are not identical, rather than yellow. And what they have noticed is that if these twins are brought up in very different types of environments, their epigenetic drifts much more and becomes more and more dissimilar in a way. So that's one of the ways that they actually prove that the environment influences your epigenetic material in a way.
and therefore if your epigenetic material is changed, it changes the way your genes are acting and also can change the, your risk of certain types of diseases. So I'm not going to go into it, but think about alternative models. If you have an animal model, in this case, like we work a lot with a crustacean called Daphnia, they're clonal. So you can have armies, millions and millions of Daphnia, that their genetic materials are identical, and you can change their environment or any factor that you're interested in and start mapping epigenetic changes with certain phenotypic responses. So you can start seeing the power of clonal individual or power of samples or species or cases that are genetically identical for epigenetic studies. So this, all of this brings us to this image. So if you imagine, these are germ cell changes and these are somatic changes. So yellow means your germ cell material and blue indicates somatic. So if you got a change in the environment, if it happens in the somatic population, it basically gets stayed within that generation because it doesn't get passed on. But as we touched, if it happens in the germ cells and it changes causes a change in imprinting genes, that's how it can get passed on to multiple generation. But also what I want to highlight is a mistake that happens in the field quite a lot. And that's separating direct exposures from transgenerational effect. So what do we mean by transgenerational? Any guesses? What does the word transgenerational mean? It's not a trick, just go for it.
Cross generation.
Exactly. So transgenerational means across generation. But for something to be categorized as an epigenetic transgenerational effect, it has to have one more key element. It has to not be a direct exposure. And what I mean by that is that, imagine a mother that's pregnant. So you got one generation, yeah? In that mother you got embryos. That's your second generation. In that embryo, you got the germ cells of the third generation. So if there is a chemical, smoking is known to change your epigenome, if there is a chemical that interferes with methylation and the reprogramming event, how many generations have you directly affected? Exactly. So you directly affected three generations. So that's across generational, but it's not transgenerational inheritance because it's not inherited, but rather a direct exposure. Now, if you see epigenetic changes in the fourth generation, that becomes your true transgenerational epigenetic inheritance. So bear that in mind, because quite a lot of people make that mistake, that if they see it on the third generation, they assume that it can be a true transgenerational epigenetic study, and quite a lot of papers in the field have to be retracted because of that mistake in a way. But you kind of need to see it in one more generation. And this has happened quite a lot. And there are a few studies that actually have shown that chemical exposures actually have changed the methylation pattern. Quite a lot of, mainly mouse studies. Some ethical issues, obviously, with human studies. So this also brings us to an interesting concept. And that's something called adult onset of disease. So basically, it's on its name, adult onset of disease. So the disease starts when you're in your adulthood. And if you think about it, if there's an epigenetic change that happens during embryogenesis, but it's not strong enough, but it causes gradually changes that build up, and it causes a higher risk and leads to a disease in adulthood, that categorizes as adult onset of disease. So that's what we mean by the term of adult onset of disease. And what we now know is that quite a lot of the diseases that we commonly refer to are actually also become categorized as adult onsets of disease, and they've been linked to epigenetic changes happening during development, quite early stages, and then leading to subsequent changes gradually building up throughout life and leading to one of these types of disease. So this slide, it basically demonstrates that But I'm not going to go through it because I want to actually start focusing on the cancer site. So imagine cancer. This is a normal cell. And these are methylation with red. So the balls are basically methylation sites, yeah? So imagine a tumor suppressor gene. Is a tumor suppressor expressed or unexpressed?
Expressed.
Exactly. So is it methylated or unmethylated at promoter region? Brilliant. So imagine there's an epigenetic change that methylates the promoter of that tumor suppressor gene. Therefore, it causes a priming event. It initiates something. So that's why they're called epidrivers. So basically, they're drivers. They drive things forward. And in a way, this shows that you also have driver mutation, because what I don't want to now change your view is that cancer is completely non-mutation related. No, it's both. So you can have driver mutations happening that drive cancer forward, but you can also have epigenetic changes happening that can drive tumorigenesis forward. Then what you have is other passenger mutation and passenger epigenetic changes. What we mean by passengers is that it's like a snowball effect. Once a site changes, then surrounding it also can change. And also as you go through life, it builds up on mutation on epigenetic changes. But they're not the actual driver. They're not something that initiated. They're the passenger event that happened. And what that does, it leads to the formation of a tumor cell. And that tumor cell can actually end up metastasizing for forming a cancer. So in a way, what we want to show is that it's a build-up of events that can happen quite earlier on. But sometimes, I'm not saying now go out thinking about quite negatively about these, because what this also shows is that sometimes, not always, but sometimes, these on their own are not sufficient to lead these, but you need the other factors to happen. So in a way, that's why they're known as adult onset of disease. So sometimes the changes can happen very early on. Those drivers can happen during embryogenesis, but then they need to build up over the lifetime, and then they might end up to form a tumor in a way. So that's why they're known as adult onsets of disease. So in the case of cancer, if you think about it, these are summary of some of the methylation changes that can happen. For example, if a promoter region becomes methylated in a tumor suppressor gene, it becomes inactive. If an oncogene becomes unmethylated, it becomes active. Also, we mentioned that methylation inhibits expression of transposable elements. Imagine now those transposable elements become unmethylated and expressed. What would be the consequence of that genome instability? Or another thing is that regions that are highly methylated, so methylated CpG sites, they're also prone to deamination. So they undergo spontaneous deamination, which means that they can also lead to mutation. So in a way, it's not always that mutation would be the first event and then an epigenetic event happens, but sometimes methylation changes can lead to a mutation as well. So these are some of the changes that happen with methylation. So this shows that concept that I just mentioned. So this is a cytosine, becomes methylated. This methylation can undergo spontaneous deamination and it gets converted to a T. Now you have a, instead of having a CG site, you have a TG site. Now it's a decision when it replicates and it separates. Depends. Now this strand, in front of the T, it will put an A. The other strand, end up putting the right thing. So it also depends on if it gets repaired or not. So in a way, they can also induce mutations as well. So this is a summary slide with a few examples of the genes. I'm not going to go through it. Go through it in your own time and have a read through it, but basically just summarizes some of the things that we just touched on that slide in a form of writing. So this is also an example. I try to include quite a lot of examples, but basically it shows the consequence of a promoter of a tumor suppressor gene becomes methylated or vice versa, and the consequence of them, with some of the examples of genes also being highlighted. One last concept that I'm going to touch on, then touch on some of the methods that we use is aging. So the reason that I want to touch on aging is because it's kind of a timely issue. So if you think about it, we are living longer, but it doesn't necessarily mean that our lifespan is extended, our health span is also extended as well. So if you think about our current situation, you hear quite a lot about the type of diseases that, for example, NHS is battling with is changing. It's changing from acute diseases to chronic diseases, yeah? And the type of diseases that we're struggling is these. So these are all diseases that usually happen with, as we age. So in a way, we, although we're living longer, we're spending much more bigger portion of our end life with diseases. Yeah, so that's not a nice feeling, is it? So the idea is that if we understand aging as a process, therefore maybe we can tackle multiple diseases at one go rather than trying to tackle each disease individually. So that's the idea behind aging research, which is shown here. So you've got quite a lot of age-associated diseases listed here, and then you've got some of the mechanisms associated with them. So one way of research is to try to tackle them when they develop and try to treat them. One is prevention of each individual disease. The other thing is to look at mechanisms behind, common mechanisms behind all of them, and understand what is it in our body that starts failing as we age. We're not trying to basically prevent people from dying because it's impossible. Aging is a natural thing, natural process. Yeah, it's not a disease. But we can prevent when these diseases maybe start appearing, slow them down in a way. One of the key things that happen during aging is epigenetic changes. So if you remember, we said that basically as we develop, as tissue differentiation happens, each of our different types of tissues will end up with a specific, unique methylation pattern. So what happens when we age? When we age, something happens known as epigenetic drift. We start off with a specific epigenetic profile for each type of tissue. As we age, that epigenetic profile, that methylation profile, starts to change and starts to drift from what it was. That's known as epigenetic drift, and the rate of that drift depends on the environment. Yeah? So certain environments can promote and accelerate that epigenetic drift, and certain environments can say, slow down that drift, and also cause us to actually age slower in a way. And these drifts are also associated with disease risk. So certain epigenetic profiles match a disease profile. So imagine if you slow down that drift, therefore consequently you would end up slowing down when that disease starts forming. And this is shown here. So this is an epigenetic profile of a young individual. This is an epigenetic profile of an older person. So what you would normally expect is, for example, in the young person, the promoter of this gene to be unmethylated and expressed. With environmental condition, with aging process, that promoter becomes methylated and the gene is no longer expressed. One of the things that also you would expect is also transposable element, repeat region. Usually need to be heavily methylated and unexpressed. With the drift of age, they lose their methylation profile and they start becoming expressed. So this is what we mean by changing the epigenetic profile as you age. So in a way, it's basically changed from the background, the normal methylation profile. So again, this is looking at a methylation profile. So this is a newborn, and this is centenarian. Again, this study is a bit biased, because how many people live to be a centenarian? Do you see what I mean? So there are also exceptional people. So we're not looking at the methylome of a normal 90-year-old or 80-year-old. So take this study with a pinch of salt. Yeah. But what it's showing is that the methylation, the colors of light blue to dark blue, indicates methylation level.
It shows that the methylation level of the chromosome 2 between a neuron and centurion is much more different. So in this study, they show that as you age, your methylation gets decreased overall. So that's why it's going towards the lighter blue, gradually indicates lower levels of methylation. So the key message to take home from this is not to actually say that your methylation levels decreases, but just to take home that your methylation changes as you age, because there's quite a lot of studies that disagree with what they're showing here. So the key take home message is to basically your methylation starts changing as you age. I don't know how many of you saw the program they did on BBC on methylation and epigenetic clock. Okay, so basically, this is a concept that was developed in 2013. So what they showed in 2013 is that you can use... I'm going to go to the clock first. You can use methylation of 353 CpG sites to predict the biological age of any tissue, any human tissue. Yeah. So, for example, let's say I ask you how old you are. I don't want to know. But I ask you how old you are, and you tell me, you know what, I'm 21, let's say. Yeah, I don't know, I'm just guessing. So, I'm 21. And I say, well, that's the age that you think you are. So that becomes your chronological age. But what is your biological age? So if I look at your tissues, what would your tissues tell me? What's the biological age of your tissue? Are you showing accelerated aging, or are you showing slow aging rate? And because we know our methylation changes as we age, we now have identified these 353 CpG sites within our chromosomes, that if we look at the methylation levels of these sites, we can take the biological age of that tissue. So the way that that study was done is that this study used quite a lot of data from healthy and diseased individuals, different multiple types of tissues, and they correlated methylation level at different ages with their actual biological and chronological age. So they saw how methylation changes as that in that healthy individual ages. And then they identified 353 CpG sites, subsets, that can be used to predict the biological age. So let's say I take a blood sample from you. I'm picking on you, but not necessarily just you. Let's pick on someone else. I'm picking on you now. So I take a blood sample from you, and I look at your methylation profile for these 353. And your methylation profile, I compare it to that database that I know a healthy individual at that specific age has to have that specific methylation for these 353. Then I compare it with your methylation profile for that 353, and I see that their methylation is slightly angling from the norm. It's either going this way or it's going that way. So it's either showing accelerated aging or it's showing reduced aging rate. That's how you determine what's the biological age of tissue. Currently, this is the only accurate biomarker for predicting the biological age of a tissue. So this is the power of epigenetic if you actually use it correctly. So let's go back and look at the slides. So this is basically trying to demonstrate that, how they came across that concept. They basically did what we saw in the other slide. They looked at methylation profiles of the entire genome from young babies, newborns to elderly people, and they look at the changes and they profile those changes and they try to predict, okay, what's the rate of those changes that are happening. And this is some of the changes that are shown here. There's no need to look at the details. If you are interested, I leave that slide up to you. If you're interested, have a look at the details of the changes, but for me this slide is just there for extra information. And we touched on this study as well. And this is the concept that we just talked about. So that's basically normal epigenetic change that happens with age. There are certain environmental conditions that drive that drift and cause premature aging, and there are certain changes that slow down that epigenetic drift and therefore slow down the development of age-associated diseases and cause healthy aging. So that's the aim of aging research. They're basically trying to slow down these epigenetic drifts that are happening, therefore a smaller proportion of your end life is with diseases in a way. So this brings me to last maybe 5-10 minutes of our session. And these slides are here because I kind of think that it's quite important to know how you can study these concepts, because you hear about them and then you think, well, how do they actually do the research on these concepts? And also, I don't know if you guys are doing projects, but if you decide to do lab-based projects, you might want to figure out, okay, what sort of experiments can I do? So I picked two different types of epigenetic modification. One is DNA methylation, the other one is histone modification. So for DNA methylation, there's several different ways that you can study it. Two of them are highlighted here. The gold standard method for studying DNA methylation is by sulfide sequencing. There are other methods, for example, MEDIP, which stands for methylated DNA immunoprecipitation, and that can be coupled with sequencing or microarray. To study histone modification, you can use the same approach, which is known as CHIP, or chromatin immunoprecipitation. So let's see what they are. So how many people know about PCR? Good. So imagine a DNA. You want to know the sequence of that DNA. What do? Exactly. You sequence it, and then what you do, you compare it to a database and you look at the sequence. Yeah? Exactly. So the problem is that if you're interested in methylation, if you PCR that DNA, you lose the methylation pattern. So there's no point PCRing it and sequencing it and looking at the sequence, because think about your PCR reaction. What do you add to your PCR reaction? Exactly. You add DNTPs. What are your four DNTPs that you're adding? DNA. And are you adding a methylated cytosine in there?
No.
Exactly. So as soon as you start amplifying, what it does is that it recognizes a C and just puts a C. So you lost your methylation pattern. So you need a step before your PCR, and that's bisulfite treatment. What sodium bisulfite does is that when you treat your DNA, so that you imagine you extract your DNA from your sample of interest, before you PCR it, you're treated with sodium bisulfite. What sodium bisulfite does is it's ineffective on methylated cytosine. So methylated cytosine stays the same, stays as methylated cytosine. But what it does, it deaminates a cytosine and it converts it to a uracil. Now you have a DNA that, if it was methylated, it has stayed as a C. If it was unmethylated, it's now converted to a U. Now you take your DNA fragment to PCR reaction and you add your four bases. So now when it sees a methylated cytosine, it does what it normally does, it adds a C. When it comes to a uracil, there's no uracil base there, yeah, in your mix. But uracil is very similar to a T, so it starts putting T there. So now when you PCR your DNA and you sequence it, you're looking at a changed sequence. If you see in your sequence a C, you know it was a methylated cytosine that's been protected during bisulfite treatment. If you see a T in your sequence and you compare to original and there should be a C there, you know that it was an unmethylated cytosine that's got converted to a U and a T during the PCR reaction. So that's the gold standard method known as bisulfite sequencing PCR. So these are the reactions. So step one, step two, and step three, which are basically the deamination reactions that I just mentioned. So there are a few good things about this method, but also there are a few bad things about this method. The good thing is that it can give you single base pair resolution
your methylation status, because you're looking at single base pair. You're sequencing it and you know exactly this should be methylated, this should be unmethylated. So single base pair. And it's quantitative. So you can see, okay, this percentage of the C at this location are coming up at C, so they should have been methylated, but I'm getting a few T. So therefore, 2 out of 10 are T, so then you can calculate the percentage of methylation. So it's quantitative, it's single base pair resolution, and it's quite accurate in terms of detecting unmethylated stuff. Downfall of this method is that usually you do whole genome wise so far sequencing, so you treat the entire DNA and you have to resequence it. To resequence a human genome, you have to have a lot of cash. So it's expensive. So that's that downfall of this method. Unless you have, similar to qPCR, few target genes that you want to know exactly this region of this method. The good thing is that it can give you single base pair resolution of your methylation status, because you're looking at single base pair. You're sequencing it and you know exactly this should be methylated, this should be unmethylated. So single base pair. And it's quantitative. So you can see, okay, this percentage of the C at this location are coming up at C, so they should have been methylated, but I'm getting a few T. So therefore, 2 out of 10 are T, so then you can calculate the percentage of methylation. So it's quantitative, it's single base pair resolution, and it's quite accurate in terms of detecting unmethylated stuff. Downfall of this method is that usually you do whole genome-wise so far sequencing, so you treat the entire DNA and you have to resequence it. To resequence a human genome, you have to have a lot of cash. So it's expensive. So that's that downfall of this method. Unless you have, similar to qPCR, few target genes that you want to know exactly this region of gene, tell me if it's methylated or not, then you can just design primers and target those genes. Otherwise, if you want to understand single base pair resolution of an entire human genome, you have to resequence the entire genome and you have to spend a lot of money. So it's expensive. The other downfall of it is that we heard that there are not just one modification, there's another modification, 5-hydroxynucleocytosine. Downfall of our gold standard method is that it can't recognize between a methylated cytosine and 5-hydroxymethylated cytosine. Both of them are protected for sodium bisulfite treatment, and they've both been recognized as a C. So if you see a C in your sequence, for sure you know that it was definitely modified, but you can't tell if it's methylated or if it's 5-hydroxymethylated. There's a very small proportion of our genome that's 5-hydroxynucleocytosine, so majority of the people assume that's a methylated cytosine, but you can't be 100% sure. So that's the two downfall of this method. This is actual data. So this is the sequencing data. So you can actually see that this is the original sequence. You see a C, this one's coming up as a T. So you know it was methylated here, it was unmethylated here, that's got converted to a T. So this is how you end up looking at the data. Now, if I don't have a lot of money, and I still want to look at the methylation, so I have to be a bit more clever. What can I do to reduce the genome size? You can use enrichment method. What I mean by that is that you can basically take your DNA and you can chop down that DNA into small pieces, and you use an antibody called 5-methylcytosine. That antibody recognizes methylated cytosine and it binds to it. And that antibody is attached to a bead as well. That's magnetic. You use a magnet and you pull out the fragments of DNA that's attached to the antibody. Now you've got two pools. The pool that's been attached to a magnet that's attached to an antibody that can recognize the methylated cytosine, and the leftover DNA that hasn't been separated, therefore it must not have 5-methylcytosine. Then what you can decide is to use a microarray. Label the ones that are pulled out with a different color versus the entire genome. And then you can look at the ratio of your colors. Or you can just basically sequence this fragment. But the downfall of this method is that although you're basically reducing the cost by enriching, you're looking at big chunks of fragments. Because you basically broke down your DNA and you said, okay, I'm pulling out these fragments. So I know there is somewhere methylation in this 60 base pair fragment, let's say, but I can't tell you exactly which CPG site is methylated and at what percentage, because you basically pull down a fragment rather than an individual CPG site. Yeah. So this is the downfall of the method. But the good thing is that basically you're enriching, so you're working with not the entire genome, you're working with the reduced section of the genome. The last method to touch on, then you're free to go, is the ChIP-seq. So let's say that there's a lab that's interested in a histone modification. The idea behind the ChIP-seq is very, very similar to MIDI. You use basically, so you're looking at protein DNA interaction. So first of all, what you do is you fix your DNA around your protein, so you use a fixer tip. Now that DNA and protein combination is fixed, then you chop off your DNA to smaller pieces, and because it's fixed around your proteins, you still get the proteins attached to it. Then you use an antibody that is of your interest. For example, let's say you use an antibody against lysine 27 terimethylation. Then what this antibody does, it recognizes any regions of the tail of a histone that has this modification, it binds to it, and then you pull it down. And then what you do is that you basically unbind it. So you separate your DNA from your histone core. And now you use the same approach. You either label them differently or you sequence them. So in this case, you're not sequencing your protein, but you're sequencing sections of the DNA that's been associated with that histone modification. So this is how you look at histone modifications in a way. Very similar to MIDI. So, and this is an example of the result. So you can either couple it again to microarray or you sequence it. So this is your epigenetic lecture. If you have got any questions, this is the time to ask. Any questions? If not, you're free to go.